Hello, hello, Mordimer here, and welcome to one more game from the fifth round of Tata Steel Chess Tournament in Eindhoven this time. As I said, the players move to Eindhoven from Wegen Zee, and they play in the stadium of PSV Eindhoven, the football club. And today I would like to show you the game with a pretty interesting attack by Jan Krzysztof Duda. Jan Krzysztof Duda is the Polish player. His ranking is 2758, and he's a pretty strong player. He's 21 years old, and in 2018 he won the Polish Chess Championship, so he became the best player in Poland, but also he became the number one ranked junior in the world at the same time, so he beat Wei Yi at that time. And during 2018 also, in Chess Olympiad in Georgia, in Batumi, he defeated Vasily Ivanchuk and also drew against Levon Aronian, Vishwanathan Anand, Fabiano Caruana, Shakhriyar Mamedyarov and Sergei Karyakin. He played on the board number one, and phenomenal score, and Polish chess team got the fourth place in this Chess Olympiad. One more thing to mention, that Duda is very strong in blitz games. For example, in December 2018, he finished in second place, just behind Magnus Carlsen, half point behind Magnus Carlsen in St. Petersburg World Blitz Chess Championship. This is quite important, because we are showing the game where players not gonna have much time at the end, so blitzing skills can be handy at that moment. And as black we have Vladislav Artemev from Russia. 2731 is his actual ranking, and young grandmaster as a Russian prodigy. He's gonna jump to the Russian national team. Maybe he's already there, as stated Alexander Grishuk. And I told a bit more about Artemev in the video couple of days ago, where he defeated Vladislav Kovalev from Belarus. So if you are interested in that game, just click the link over there, and then you can see the game. So warm welcome for both of the players, and let's see what happened on the board. We have d4 by Duda, d5, c4, c6, so Slav defense. Interesting thing, but both players are, you know, Slav. Duda is from Poland and Artemev is from Russia, so both of them are Slavic people. Knight f3, knight f6, knight c3, and e6. So we have Semi-Slav chosen by Artemev, and now we have e3. Knight b on d7, queen c2, bishop d6, so far the most popular line here, and we have bishop on d3 by Duda. Castle, and we have d takes on c4, and the, of course bishop has to take on c4, so pretty standard so far. And the most popular plan for black would be kicking out the bishop, moving a6 and playing c5 with some attacking chances on the queen side. Of course, light square bishop can easily be moved to the longest diagonal. A lot of interesting games by these systems. In the database we have thousands of that games. But Artemev choose e5, so less popular approach to that. We have h3, and we have e takes on d4. And here there are two options for white. They can play more safely, or e takes on d4, creating the isolated queen's pawn, which which force white to do some attacks. So there are some attacking chances for white, and black decide to be a defender here. Knight on b6, bishop b3. Usually in these openings bishops go on d3, but it's bishop b3 is more popular and more handy, and I will show you why it's like that. So we have knight from b to d5, bishop on g5, pinning the knight, and bishop e7, immediately unpinning. Rook f on e1, and bishop on e6. Duda play e5, rook on e5 in this position. He knows that position very well. It's also still one of the popular lines. Queen d7, rook a on e1, so the rooks are, you know, doubled on the open e file. Very important achievement here. And we have a rook from a to e8. So Artemev decided to create, you know, watch at this, all the pieces are brought to the defense of the king. That's not gonna be easy to, you know, defeat all of these defenders. The pieces looks like, you know, they don't have much space, but they are actually pretty nice coordinated. We have queen on d2, bishop d8. So bishop gives the space for the rook to give the extra defender on e6, just in case if Duda would like to sacrifice on e6. Have to be very careful. And bishop on c2. So as you see, bishop belongs to that diagonal. And now with this isolated queen's pawn, it's as you see, white just has to have attacking chances. And now black queen on c8, and look at this position. That's something interesting, that all these pieces are on the 8th rank. Okay, let's make some joke. Feel free to pause the video and find the fastest way to set up the pieces in the Fischer random for black. Okay, while I enjoy my cup of tea. Okay, so how many did you find? I found like knight can go to c7 and then to a8. So that would be one move. Queen to b8, and bishop to c8, also king on h8, and knight on g8. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 moves. So I found in 6 moves, probably that's the fastest way. So if you found in 6 moves, congratulations, you just had some fun. And if you are faster, share in the comments. But I don't think it can be done a faster way. But let's back to the game. Duda play bishop on h6, so that's the first sacrifice by Duda. And as you see, he destroy all chances of Artemev to, you know, create the Fischer random setup. So this bishop can't be taken. If Artemev tried to take that bishop, we would have queen on h6, knight on e7, and knight e4 actually attacks this this knight twice. And black would have a really difficult time. For example, if they move the knight to d5, then this is the threat. Rook on g5, check. Knight g6. So, you know, trying to build some fortress, some kind of fortress. But then we have rook on h5. Knight f6, defending. But then we have knight f6, bishop f6, and queen on h7, checkmate. So knight f to d5 is impossible to play. What about knight f5? It's similar. Knight f6 takes with check. Bishop f6, queen f6, queen d8, trying to exchange the queens, and queens actually can be exchanged, and bishop can take on f5, win the piece, and of course the game, because with extra knight, it's completely winning for white. So definitely a bishop on h6 can't be taken. So we have knight on e7, bringing some defender to the king, and we have knight on e4, in very similar fashion, knight f5, so all the motives are pretty similar. And now we have the bluff. Jan Krzysztof Duda decide to bluff, and interesting thing that 18 minutes for Artemiev on the clock and 22 minutes for Jan Krzysztof Duda on the clock, and both players still have to make 20 moves. The move recommended by the engine in that situation would be rather moving the bishop on g5 or f4, even better, and just continue the game. But you know, that's human, and human started the attack, so try the best to doing his duty and making the game interesting. Bishop on g7, so we have another sacrifice. And this time, first Artemiev decide to take on e4, exchange these knights. A rook from first rank goes to e4, and only now knight on g7. So all is good for black. Now we have queen on h6, so bringing more attackers, and the best defending move, f5. Cutting this bishop from the h7, and h7 can't be defended very easily, as the knight is misplaced on g7. He is defending the king, but from f6 he could defend h7 as well. And now Duda found a rook on g4, and a rook on g4 is another bluff by Duda. This rook, do you think the rook can be taken? Actually, yes, f on g4, and we would have queen on h7, king f7, so escaping, there is some way for escaping, but not so easy. Bishop on g6, king e7, queen g7, so taking another piece, the knight, king d6, and now bishop e8, so getting the exchange, rook e8, and now just take the pawn on g4, queen d7, trying to exchange, and black are down 3 pawns, but have pair of bishop against the knight. So knight and 3 pawns against pair of bishop. Black stands better here, would have probably easier game. White would have to try to, you know, create some advantage with these passed pawns, but once black exchanged the queens, the game should be easier for black. So that was actually quite a bluff by Duda. But Artemiev having 15 minutes on the clock and Duda having 10 minutes on the clock, and remember that Duda is pretty good in blitzing, and a lot of his games he play very slow in opening, in the middle game, and then making a lot of complications with the game, very fast game, and he won a lot of games in this style. So we have bishop on f6 by Artemiev, so he didn't take that rook. We have knight on g5, so now creating the threat, and the threat is of course checkmate, so this knight has to be taken. Bishop takes on g5, we have rook takes on g5, creating another mating ideas, and now we have queen on d7. More precise would be rook on f7. Rook on f7, and I will show you why. Because queen on d7 let Duda to make some interesting tactic. d5, c takes on d5, and now bishop go on a4. And bishop attacks the queen, and x-raying the rook. So the queen has to be moved, because if the queen is moved from the position from d7, from the 7th rank, then white, of course, checkmate on g7. So queen f7, and here we have bishop on e8. However, maybe for Duda would be better to make some extra combination, especially now we have just moved 28, so it's still 12 moves to do, and Artemiev have 44 seconds on the clock. And yes, there is 30 seconds incrementation, but it's still 12 moves and have to have around 30-35 seconds for each of them. So exchanging the pieces maybe would not be the best. Maybe Duda could try, for example, rook e3, trying to make some, you know, some extra complications, like rook e7, bringing the rook to e7 rank, and still defending the bishop on e6, and of course getting away from the harm from the bishop's way. We would have rook on g7, queen g7, rook g3, and now the queen is trapped here, so has to be exchanged for the rook. And after f takes on g3, situation of white would be probably better. Yes, the rooks are preferable in the endgame like that, but look at these pawn islands. There are a lot of pawn islands, 4 of them for black, and white are much better consolidated with only 2 pawn islands, so probably would be easier for white to handle that, and the game would be maybe more interesting, more complicated, who knows. However, in this position, Duda decided to exchange the pieces. He thought that he's gonna have a better endgame. So bishop takes on e8, rook takes on e8, and now there are some tactics to equalize the material. So for example, rook takes on e6, rook takes on e6, rook takes on g7, and after queen on g7 takes on e6 with check. So this is the way how Duda handled that, exchange all the pieces by quite fancy way. We have a queen on f7, and here is the probably critical moment for Duda. He thought that these 4 islands are a very big weakness and he can handle the end game. Probably his best way to approach that situation would be queen moving to d6, so avoiding to exchange the queens. And now black, yes, defending everything very nicely, but the position of this queen is like very passive. So white would have quite easier way to play, just bring the king to the center, maybe centralize the queen and then try to win some material, maybe this way, or maybe even this way, up to the situation, up to the approach of Artemiev. So exchanging the queens in this position probably were a mistake. But Duda did that, and probably he believed that this endgame is still winning. We have king f1, king e6, king e2, f4, and now we have g4. We have f takes on g3, f takes on g3. So Duda created 2 pawns on the king side against 1 pawn by the black side. And it looks like white have that quite big chances for winning. We have king on e5 and king to e3, creating some opposition for black. We have d4, and now what to play now? Actually doesn't matter much, because all the ways are drawish. For example, if Duda goes on d3 with his king, we would have a5, probably b3, because if e3 trying to play that, then it's a little trap, a4, and white are stuck on this side, and b pawn can't be moved, so that would be quite disaster. This is why b3 probably, b5, a3, b4, a5, a4, king d5, g4, now king e5, g5, and black still have the time to play even king d5. We would have h4, king e5, h5, and only now king on f5. We would have g6, h takes on g6, h takes on g6, king g6, king d4, and it looks like white is winning. But is that true? How did you calculate that? Look at this. King f5, king c5, king e5, king b5, king d4 now, king a5, king c3, king b6, king b3, a5, king c3, and the pawns just marching to promotion at exactly the same time, and even black comes with the check. So yeah, that's what would happen if king d3 would be played. So it looks like a very logical move, and white can win easily, but actually it just looks this way, but it seems like it's a pretty drawish. So Duda calculated that, so he tried to make the things more spicy. He go king on f3, we have king on f5, g4 check, king g5, king g3 by Duda, and now we have d3. So white has to you know, bring the king back, but of course first h4 check, king f6, and only now king f3, king e5, king e3, d2, king takes on d2, and king f4. So a black king has the space to flank the white pawns, and it looks now like black has advantage and they gonna win. Just, you know, pick up these two pawns and move the pawn here, while the black also can come and get the pawns on the queen side. But it only look like that. It's the same situation. We have g5, king g4, king e3, king h4, and then white on time on f4. So we had a6 trying to win some tempo, but it actually doesn't really matter. A3, b6, a4, a5, b3, king h3, king f3, king h4, and in this position the players agreed to a draw. As it's completely drawish, probably just threefold repetition here, and nothing can be done. So pretty nice attack, but end up in a draw. So yeah, Jan Krzysztof Duda half points, and after round five he has 2.5 points, drawing all the games, which doesn't happen often. Usually he play quite offensively, but this is a strong tournament. He gonna look for his chances against other opponents, and yeah, that's all for today. Thank you for watching. Don't forget to like that video if you like, of course, but if you don't like, feel free to press unlike, and comment what games would you like to see. And yeah, thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.